So hi everybody, I'm Stefan, and today I want to talk to you about how we used Kotlin at our company and leveraged features while we're parsing JSON. So I work at Kitchen Stories, which is a Berlin-based startup, and just to summarize, under the slogan "Everyone can cook," we try to bring for free a multimedia cooking experience to everybody at home, and that's where we work, where I work right now. And I guess everybody has seen last year's I/O and the biggest announcement of last year's I/O. After that, I tried to convince our design team to change the logo to this. They're not quite yet on board, but maybe I will manage after we migrated everything to Kotlin. Because right now we're already at 75% Kotlin adoption. Within 1 year, I guess that's quite good. And this talk is going to be about one of our first migrations. So it starts like every good story starts. How can you make your product owner happy? What we have right now, and I would just want to summarize it really quick, is that we have an API that cannot be so easily changed because our team is quite slim and our backend guys are really busy. But we have a quite complicated API because our content is delivered into 12 languages, and then we have a content team translating recipes and articles in-house, and sometimes they tend to forget to enter something in the field. And what we had because of that, there was what we considered broken content delivered via the API to the app, and our app crashed. Just null pointer exception because title was null for some reason for an article or a recipe. And what we wanted to have is less of those content-related crashes. And at the same time, we were trying to get rid of all those tedious null checks, like is the recipe null? Is the title of the recipe null, or is the author of the recipe null, and then is the name of the author of the recipe null, and you get the gist. It can be like three lines of if statements just to check if you can read a field without having the app crash. And we had to write a lot of those code, and we still had crashes. And every time there was like a big crash, we fixed, of course, the content-related bug, but there were just a lot. So we were trying to solve this problem at an earlier stage and just filter this broken content instead of using it within the app. So that was our goal. And just to wake you guys all up a little, it's a little quiz time. How many different ways do you think are there to define a string in a JSON? And I know the question is quite difficult to grasp, so I will just help you out. Of course, you can have a field and it has some text. That's just a valid definition. That's the first option. There's a second option, that the field is just null. Of course, there's always that. The API can say there's no field in this case. But there's also a third option, and maybe some people tend to forget that, that the field is just not sent. And keep that in mind, because it's going to be important for the rest of the talk. So I'll just dive right into an example, a pretty easy example I guess everybody can grasp, which is an actual example of our API and our content. So we have recipes and also articles. And articles are fairly simple. They have a title, they have a subtitle, they can have a banner image, which we call cell image, and then they have an author. And then content is a list of items, comments is a list of items. I abbreviated a little bit for you to have a better overview. And what we had before was this ugly Java class, I would say, because I didn't put everything on here. We still had to define getters and setters for all the fields. We had to find the constructors, and we had to define if we want to compare articles to each other in equals method and so on. And we simply just converted it to Kotlin, and after that it looks like this. I can just show you once again, because I like the animation. But you see every field stays at the same spot, and it looks like not a lot has changed, but I want to dive into it, because I'm not sure if everybody is familiar with the concepts of Kotlin and what we're actually using here. So to be on the same page, First of all, I clean it up a little bit because I don't quite like the snake case. So you can easily just rename the field to something else. And of course, you still have to tell it what the actual field in the JSON later is so that it knows. Keep that in mind if you do this. But for a better overview, I will leave it out now. And now let's dive into the Kotlin class because it's quite interesting. First of all, I just told you in Java we had to write all the getters, setters, constructors, everything. In Kotlin, these are four letters, data. You just write a data class, and then it generates for all fields, getters and setters, an equals method, a hash function, and also a nice function which is called copy, where you can just copy instances and just overwrite values. You can say copy with a new title, and then you have a new article with a different title, but everything else stays the same. Since we are loading the data from the backend, there's no reason for us to change it, so we made the fields immutable. You could do this in Java too, but we just decided to do this change here. So with val, you can easily say this field cannot change. If you want to have a changing field, it's var in Kotlin. So one of the really nice features of Kotlin is in a data class with a constructor like this, you can provide default parameters. So when you remember back the quiz, options three, if our API doesn't send, for example, a subtitle or no content because there is none, then we could reason about it already at the parsing step and initialize fields with other values if they are missing. So if there's no subtitle in Java, it passed that as null. But there's no real meaning behind having a nullable subtitle. So for us, it's just an empty string in this case. And it is even better with lists, like you can see with content and comment, because we don't have nullable lists anymore. We just have empty lists. So we don't have to check for null before we access the list. It's just empty if our API sends no content or no comments. And like count is zero. with all these default parameters, those fields become more or less optional fields. Our JSON API doesn't have to send those fields. We can reason about how to display the content if they are not available. Those four fields become, on the other side, mandatory fields because we don't provide default values. There needs to be data sent via the API that fills those fields. Otherwise, the whole parsing process would crash. So we cannot use an article without a title in the app anywhere. That's why already at the design phase, we decided to have title as a mandatory field, and the same goes for image and author. And there's one special field, which is this one. Every field is not nullable by default, except in Kotlin, except you put a question mark behind it. So the only nullable field in our model is video. So I guess you're all familiar with our models now. In part two of the talk, I will just show you how you can parse data actually in Android. And of course, you could write your own parse, or you find a parsing library that works really well with Kotlin. Doing my research, I found three. First is Kotzen, which has a weird name if you speak German, as you just realized. Jackson is a quite popular one for backend guys, but it's a huge library. That's why it's not really recommended for mobile use. And then there's Moshi, developed by Square. And of course, at this point, I could compare all of them, do benchmarks and everything, but I will skip this part and just tell you how to set up Moshi. Two easy steps. First, you add it to your build.gradle. So the latest version of Moshi is 1.6. When I first built the slides, it was 1.5, but I managed to update the slides. You just implement Moshi, and then you can right away pass Java. That's everything you need. If you want to leverage all the Kotlin features I just showed you, you have two options. Version A is you add another adapter, which is bundled in Moshi Kotlin plugin. And in version 1.0, and this adapter adds the Kotlin Reflect library. So again, really big library in your small APK. Or the new version coming with Moshi 1.6 is adding Kotlin code generation. And in this case, it generates for every class you want to pass an adapter at build time. So I would say version B, B stands for better in this case, because you don't have to ship Kotlin Reflect anymore, and A, you can count as another deprecated version maybe, so let's just get version A out of the equation and work with version B. Then there's step two, set up a Moshi adapter, which you use for parsing, and okay, there's still version A here, I just want to show for complete list how you would use it. So there's a magic part where it can be dragons and rainbows and adapters for your parsing, and you just add one adapter, which is the Kotlin JSON adapter factory, and then it can do all the stuff I just showed you with constructor default values and everything when you pass JSON into Kotlin modules. Before that, without this adapter, it couldn't do this. But like I said, there's version B. B stands for better. You don't need to add any adapter if you will use version B. You just go back to your model and you say, generate an adapter for this. That's it. And now it generates at build time all the adapters it needs and works quite well. So if version B doesn't work for you, you can always go back to version A, but if it works, prefer version B. yeah, and step three I will leave out, but it's pretty easy to set up Moshi to use to work with retrofit or whatever layer for loading the data actually is. And we thought we managed to do everything now, and that's the end. But is it really the end? Of course not. That would be a quite short presentation. What do you do if you want to verify what I just told you? Pretty easy question. Of course, you write tests. And there's a repo I built where I put all the setup and everything, all the models I showed you, and even more, where you can check out what I described, and there are really nice tests you can see on how everything works. And while writing those tests, we figured out three problems we have to solve. One fairly easy, Moshi doesn't know how to translate a date, and two more difficult ones, I will get to that once a minute later. How can we tell Moshi that it should pass it, how it should pass a date? That's pretty easy. There's also a plugin Moshi adapters where there is a RFIC and so on JSON adapter, and you just add that one to your Moshi adapter pipeline, and it knows how to pass a date. Fairly simple. Now, for that example to understand better, I will go back to the article. Like I told you, we have mandatory fields in our article, and we don't want to work with an article that doesn't have that. So, but what happens if one of those fields is missing in the JSON when you're parsing? Simple, it's a crash. And we had to find a solution how to remove those crashes, because we had those crashes before and we didn't want to have them anymore. So luckily, in the Moshi examples, there was this adapter I converted to Kotlin. There's not so much you need to understand about how it works. At the longer presentation, I talked about how it works, but what it does is fairly simple. You add it to your build pipeline again. You define the mismatch adapter and say, for articles, when the parsing process crashes, don't crash, instead return a null. You can, but this adapter is pretty pretty flexible. You can also use it, for example, to parse an enum, and if it doesn't match anything in your enum, you could just say, well, instead of crashing, just assume aspect ratio is unknown, or you can even return, like for an article page, in our example, article page is just a list of articles in an object, you can just return an empty article page. And this way, we managed to get this crash out of the way, but then we found another crash, which is not really unique to our solution, what we are doing, but a problem how Moshi in general serializes JSON into models. And there are lists that can that are declared in Kotlin as non-nullable, and they can contain nullable stuff. So I can easiest describe it with content and comments. As you can see, content and comment doesn't have this question mark, so content and comment are supposed to be not null in the list. But somehow Moshi manages to serialize nulls into this list, and then later on it crashes when you use the list. Another fancy adapter, it's in the repo, you can check it out. But what it does is more or less the same. I add it to the pipeline and I say for content, just filter out null values out of the list. Okay. And I can do the same for comment, and that's it. All tests are passing. Success. So, a little summary for everybody who fell asleep, too long fell asleep. I will just summarize everything I just said because, first of all, Kotlin is fun. It's awesome. It's really, really fun, and if you haven't used it yet, I hope I convinced you to leverage some of the features Kotlin provides because it is really fun to work with. It puts fun back into programming because methods are called fun, but also because it is fun. But it's a tool, so use it as a tool. Don't stick to Java because you're used to Java. Use Kotlin as a tool as you would with Java. I showed you all the nice features like immutability, non-nullable fields, and constructed default values and data classes. You can all check them out on the Kotlin docus, fairly simple to understand. Then, I talked about how we pass JSON into one of those models and our key challenge, how we filter broken content from what we pass. And we found a workaround for the list bug, which is actually a real bug in Moshi, and they don't know how to fix it themselves. But with this workaround, you can at least work around this. And just to keep it complete, maybe this the solution with the adapters I showed you doesn't scale really well for thousands of models. In this case, would be good to also do some auto-generation or something like that, but I haven't managed to do that yet and probably won't. So here are all the links. I'm not quite sure how this slide got in there, but it's probably important. But I'm really thankful for listening. I'm looking forward to feedback. The only reason I'm sharing this is because we want to have feedback and discussion on how you would do it differently. So if you have any questions and understanding or recommendations or whatever, you can call, you can write me on Twitter, you can just come back to the stage. I'm not sure if there are time for real questions via mic, or you can submit pull requests to the repo. I would be glad about that as well. Thank you.